today is the first Sunday after Ascension. And the text that we will hear today is in that context. And that text can be Gospel of John, 17th chapter, verses 1 through 11. And that's on page 111 in the New Testament. John 17, verses 1 through 11, page 111. After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people, to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I've made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words that you gave to me, I have given to them. And they have received them and know in truth that I came from you. And they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me. Because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine. And I have been glorified in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one." The word of God in Scripture. For the word of God among us, for the word of God within us. Thanks be to God. In these Sundays, Easter, we have spent a lot of time in the Gospel of John, in particular, his messages between Jesus and his disciples as he is doing what we call the farewell address. Jesus knows that he is going to his death on the cross, and he's trying to comfort and assure his disciples that even though he will be killed, that they will not be left as orphans. Today we come to this prayer, which is the conclusion of these passages that talk about how Jesus is caring for those who will be left after he's gone. His compassion shines through, his concern, his diligence in teaching, touching, taking time with them. All the things that we as a congregation try to do when we are amongst those who have lost someone in death. Try to be there for them. A pastor tells of a young woman, and I've seen the same story played out on TV movies and things, but it's a young woman who has twin girls. They're toddlers. She's in love. They have a wonderful She goes in for her postpartum checkup and is told that she has terminal cancer and will die. At first, she, like many of us dealing with grief, is in denial, seeking out every possible solution that will keep her alive and prevent her from dying because she has these twin toddlers that she can't bear to part with. She looks at them and she sees in them their need, their vulnerability. So much that she sees in them is absent of all the things she knows that need to learn as they grow older. And so she begins to worry about them more than she worries about herself. And as the disease progresses, she begins to think more and more, how can I, even in death, stay alive for these two young girls? And so she decides to make a series of tapes, videotapes, where at each stage of their development, you know, school starting and graduations and college, dating, marriage, she makes a tape with some motherly care and compassion for them, but also gentle advice. The knowledge she knows they will need to grow into full adults, to live a life of compassion, and with all grace and fortitude, live to a life beyond her own years. Hearing this story, we can kind of imagine how Jesus understood his relationship with the disciples and his relationship with us as well. For none of us can see Jesus. Jesus has ascended into heaven, and as our scripture teaches us, sits at the right hand of God the Father. What we know of Jesus, the truth of his spirit, comes to us as spirit. But Jesus himself is clouded by a veil. Jesus, in his physical bodily form, is beyond our ability to envision. Jesus knew that this was inevitable, this would happen. Jesus chose to be and was created to be God among us, God with us. And part of that was a willingness to be vulnerable to the pain and the loss and the sorrow that human beings go through in life. Part of that was a willingness to be vulnerable to the bigotry, the hatred of his religious tradition for those who wanted to challenge the powers of the Part of it was being vulnerable to the empire that controlled the very world he lived in, along with his neighbors, his family. He does not come from the rich and powerful of the cities. He comes from Nazareth, a poor country dirt road town, where his father worked as a carpenter. And I've often suspected his biggest job was making crosses for the Roman Empire. After all, Nazareth just sits down from the hillside from a Jewish city that the Romans destroyed years before they destroyed Rome, or Jerusalem. And knowing the Romans, we know they used a lot of crosses. But Jesus knows that as hard as he's tried, more often than not, his disciples just don't get it. They think he is one thing when in fact he's trying to teach them and show them that he is something totally different. He is not the Messiah who's coming on a war horse to challenge the Roman Empire through might of arms. He is the humble servant who has come in peace, to be with community, to heal, to love, to feed, to teach. That's not what the disciples expected. And they really wouldn't get that till much later on after Jesus had ascended and they started to remember. Memory is such a marvelous thing. They started to remember the words he said and they told it over and over and over until somebody had this marvelous idea to write it down. And from the very beginning, it was the way that those of us who seek to follow in the way of Jesus have tried to understand what that actually means. Because following Jesus in this world is not something the world accepts. The church through the centuries has tried to find some common ground between empire and faith. But the reality is, empire's faith is not the faith of Christ. And you can't meld the two any more than you can take Pilate and Jesus and call them the same. Or the Pope and Donald Trump. They're not the same. Their kingdoms are different types of kingdoms. Their empire are different types of empire. One is of peace. One is of war. One is of healing. One is of destruction and death. Jesus has spent his short ministry, his short life, trying to teach people this truth. Not only in the words that he teaches, like on the Sermon on the Mount, or in other places, in the synagogue, but in the very way he lives his life, from town to town, from village to village, from hilltop to hilltop, from boat to boat as he traveled to the Sea of Tiberias. He lived the way he hoped his disciples would live. And that's our challenge. Make no mistake of that. It is a challenge. Everything about our culture wants us to put our faith secondary to our own well-being, our own needs. The influence and pressure we get from our colleagues at work, the culture we live in, the entertainment we choose. All these things that the world says, there's nothing wrong with this. This is just human life. Drink and be merry. Or drugs and alcohol, whatever it is. Now, I'm not one to claim piety over others. I am, as Paul would say, a chief among all sinners. I know that. And I try to keep that in mind, not only when I'm preaching, but when I'm with the community. This is what Jesus is asking of me, and I think it's what Jesus is asking of those who would follow as well. Not to judge others, not to be high and mighty on some kind of righteous trip. To actually do what Jesus did. He ate with sinners. He touched lepers. He respected women when the culture around him saw women as property. With very little value beyond a donkey. Jesus saw people as human beings, and he came as God incarnate, as a human being, and he wanted his disciples to understand that. That if you're going to follow in the way of Jesus of Nazareth, you have to learn to be a human being.
Yep.
A human being that is about creation, not destruction. A human being who is about peace and not war. A human being who is struggling to unify his family, his neighborhood, his congregation, even the whole world, as Christ sought to unify and bring salvation to the whole world. That's what is before us if we want to be followers in the way. Glory is a big word. And those of us who spent some time protesting against this war or that war are a little skittish about the word glory, because all too often it's used too easily. Usually talking about those who were killed in war. But as any veteran will tell you, there is no glory in war but survival. There's nothing glorious about battle. There's nothing glorious about seeing bodies blown into pieces. Children, women, civilians, even more of those than ever have worn a uniform. In any war there's ever been fought. So glory is a difficult word for those of us who live in the shadow of empire. But yet, here again, what Jesus is talking about when he talks about glory is not the same type of glory that is proclaimed by the empire and our military and industrial complex, all that goes with it. The glory that Jesus is talking about comes from this unity between the Father and the Son, between the Son and those who would seek to follow him, those human beings that were given to him as a human being incarnate. And it's that unity that binds us to Jesus and binds us to God that provides the Christian understanding of exactly what glory means. Glory means to be one with God, one with Jesus, and God one with us as well. We become truly the human beings we were created to be because we are filled with the glory of God that was given to us when we were created. And not just us humans. Part of the problem with empire is they're all about destruction, and that includes drinking water, breathable air, creatures of the land and sea. Creation for the empire is just something to be consumed and destroyed and move on to the next. But the kingdom of Jesus teaches is one of reconciliation and redemption, in which all of creation, human and otherwise, are reconciled and redeemed and become unified in the image of God as revealed in the human Jesus, who was fully God and was fully human. I hard message for the living in mind. We've heard Jesus talk about the rich man and how hard it is for a rich man to get through the eye of a needle, the little short gate beside the big gate into the wall of the city. That's the empire. It can't get through the small gate because all it cares about is not its riches and its ability to gain wealth through destruction and war. But we live as a cloud of witnesses. Jesus is beyond the clouds and is invisible to us, but we witness to his presence even though we cannot see them. And we witness, we are a cloud of witnesses because we are not orphaned. We have a counselor, a teacher, a spirit that moves among each of us. And as we breathe that spirit in, as we live that life of spirit, we become one with God, one with Jesus, and God and Jesus one with us. And in that unity, we become the church of Jesus Christ. We become followers of his way of seeing, of being, of witnessing to a God who creates, restores, and redeems. And that is the glory that God has left us to the life and death and resurrection of this human being from Nazareth that we know as a friend. We call him Jesus. And it's through the Spirit that we can see that living man within one another. We can see the unity in each other that is God incarnate within us, that unifies us with all that is, all that came before, and all that will come after. Alpha.
So I'm sorry, Abel, please stand for our hymn number 2.